Okay, the recording started, but before it starts, I would like you to say hi to my classmates because I will submit the video. So everybody, say hi to my classmate, my teacher. Okay. Okay. Thank you. And so let's start with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for providing us this chance to get together and so that we can have some understanding about the Christian history and about the history of Christian also. So may you guide us in our sharing, and so that we will able to understand more how to get closer with you and how to be a better Christian for the church. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This is so exciting. So I'm looking forward to this time to share this message with everyone. So the topic is, can you see the fire and God in Blaise, Pascal? And this is for my Christian history study that is in the Gateway Seminary. But it is not just for my class, okay? So it is also about you. I want the message that is related to you, not just for my homework, okay? So my homework is important, but then you are even more important than my homework. Okay. So let's start with the scripture. And let's read the scriptures together. And the scripture has three verses from the book of Exodus, book of John, and book of Jeremiah. So let's read together for the first one. God furthermore said to Moses, thus you shall you say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial name to all generations. And then John 20, 17. Jesus said to her, stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. And the last one, Jeremiah 2, 13. For my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, to heal for themselves Christians, broken Christians that can hold no water. Okay. So we are talking about the historical people we are talking tonight. His name is Blaise Pascal. Okay, so everyone, supposedly, you should know him. Okay. Because you go to the class, you use the map, the Pascal triangle, right angle triangle. So you need to know him. If you don't know him, then you will have problem in your class. Okay? The triangle, he has the famous triangle. And then besides the famous triangle, he has the famous Pascal's law. The Pascal's law, it is measuring the depth of the fluid or the liquid or whatever to measure the pressure. And then those pressure, the hydraulic system that is being used, the math being used in those reservoirs, the dams. Look at the dams, they have a narrow concrete on the top and then getting thicker and thicker and thicker. Otherwise the dam will be too weak on the bottom, right? And then so the water you are drinking today, the water you drink water today. The water you drink today is from the reservoir that is constructed with Pascal's law. Okay. So those hydraulic systems. What about the car? What components inside the car has hydraulic system?
Can you tell me? Steering.
Power steering, yeah. What else? Brakes, anti-lock brake system. Okay. And one thing, one invention that is using his hydraulic system, the kids doesn't like. Syringe. Syringe.
Oh, syringe.
Yeah. Those syringe, well, he invented the syringe. That was also so syringe. It's like you have bigger area at the center and then go to finer point. That's also invented by Pascal. That's just his one of his inventions, hydraulic system, the Pascal's law. The vacuum. Vacuum is the aviation system to measure how high we are in the altitude. That's also that's the barometer. It's invented by him too. The barometer to measure how high altitude we are. That's also invented by him. Probability theory. Oh, okay, of course, roll a die, right? What's the chance to see one out of the six? So you are supposed to know too. But not only the probability for rolling a die, the same probability theory is being used in risk management, investment. The stock market go up or down tomorrow, someone will tell you. So if you want to buy stock, then you will use a lot of Pascal's result. Cognitive equation. Anyone can tell me what kind of lines inside the cognitive equations? The basic one, of course, is the straight line. And then higher order one would be what? Like this. The circle, right? And what? Progress, hyperboles, ellipse, those are the conics. And then the conic equation from Pascal govern the orbit of the moon around the Earth, orbit the Earth around the sun, orbits those stars, how they evolve around each other. That is the Cognac equation. He is the inventor, he discovered the Cognac equation. The Pascal triangle, the famous Pascal triangle. So those Pascal triangle, it tells you the shape. Let's say the pine cone. When you see the pine cone, it has the small seed going around like a circle, right? It is the Fibonacci relationship can be modeled by Pascal triangle. Look at the stars. When you look at the galaxy, some shape of the galaxy when the Hubble telescope, they show you those stars spinning around like a whirlpool. Those shape of the whirlpool also follow the Pascal triangle's numbers. Oh, okay, calculating machine. His father is a tax officer. And he has to do a lot of calculation. And he see, oh, those calculations is tedious. There's a lot of error from the calculations. He invented a calculator, not the same calculator you have today, but the calculator that's no electronics, all gears, all machines. That's the very first mechanical calculator. And the calculator is now in the Paris Museum. So he is the one who invented all of this, many more. So like the public transit system, he is the one that established the first public transit system. But then by that time, there's no bus, he used horse. And then the people ride on the carriage. And then also your watch, hand watch. Also is so many. Such a great scientist. We want to understand, spend some time to understand this great scientist, okay? This great scientist, what happened before and around that time, okay? So we want to know the event happened before and not after. So he's a Christian. The very important events that happened before Pascal Christian, so he is around 1600. That is what? That's the Catholic Reformation. And then the Catholic Reformation split the Protestant out. Okay? So you have the Catholic people, and then we have their Protestants, and then that's the new church. And then those split into today, we are in Baptist Church. So it's one of the denominations. So there are so many, but that's the famous event on the Reformation. So who else? What else happened? Matteo Ricci is the famous Catholic missionary. He went to one place that is very, very related to us. China. He is the one that carry all the Bible, and also he carry also a technology together into China, Matteo Ricci. And he's related to us. So, I mean, Catholic has a lot of good Catholic people and related to us too. That's what I want to emphasize. And Pascal, he was born at 1623 and passed away at 1662. He was like 39 years old. 39, okay? 39 years old, very young. I'm older than 39. So he passed away when he was 39 years old, really young. And then, look, he was overlapping with the 30 Years War. The 30 Years War is the catastrophic war in Europe. Over 8 million casualties happened. So a very serious war. They are fighting. The beginning fighting is the Protestant and the Catholic begin fighting. And then everybody start to fight, and then fight more because of the politics, because of some military. So all of those events all combined together. Okay, so we have some understanding before around the time for Pascal. But what else we want to learn from here? We want to learn to understand more about different belief. Even inside Christian, there are 2 billion Christians in the world now. And so there are so many different denominations. So I hope this is the time. I hope you can take a chance to see if we can know more about other denominations. Okay. And where Pascal lived most of the time? He lived in France, Paris. And then that's one place that's very important that is related to him is the Port Royal. Port Royal is his sister. He has two sisters, one younger sister, one older sister. His younger sister, she devoted to be a nun inside Port Royal. Port Royal is the monastery for the nuns. Okay. So we will cover more about the Port Royal. Okay, so now we have a Christian scientist. I want to call him Christian scientist instead of scientist Christian. So because Christian first. So he has so many different famous publications because he is a math scientist. He is a mechanical scientist. He has so many different inventions, and then he is a physics scientist. Of course, you have tons of papers. Whoever called doctor or whatever, you will have papers, right? And then he has him too. But then two publications that can help us to understand more about this scientist's mind. We want to understand what's the faith of this scientist. And then we can tell some from his two publications. One is called the Pensée. One is called the Provincial Letters. Pensée means thoughts. Before he is able to finish the Pensée book, he passed away. So it's a lot of thinking about God. A lot of thinking about God inside. And Provincial Letter is the apologetic, so argument on theology. So, from these two books, how can we understand this scientist's mind? Okay. So he is a scientist, a Christian scientist with a Christian heart and a Christian head. Okay? Christian heart and Christian head. Heart is something that you believe, you have faith on. Christian head is something that you can analyze, you can do logics, you can do math, you can do physics. So he has two, he has a heart and a head inside him. And he said, the heart, inside his pensée, he said, the heart has its reasons which reason does not know. Okay, the heart is his Christian heart. Okay, his Christian heart has its reasons, something the heart know, the reasons. Which reason? Reason is his Christian head. He calls his Christian head as reason. Okay? His Christian head doesn't understand. What about yourself? Does your head know everything your heart knows? Your heart knows something you can't explain. It's inside your head. You just never can make sense out of it. Do you have something like this? What about love? About faith. So those are inside your heart. It's inside your heart that you have, you know, your heart has many, many things, but your head cannot make sense out of it. Right? So he has this conflict. His head wants to know more. His heart knows something else. I mean, it is someone heart want you to go left, and then the head want you to go to the right. You have conflict. It's just now that the scientists want to understand more about Bible, about God. I mean, does God exist? I mean, those are the questions that always inside his mind. If I keep doing research on the scientists, would I able to find something that I will reach God? So that's reason and heart. But then he realized one thing. Okay. Once he realized this thing, he knows so much more. This conflict will have harmony. How to get harmony for these two sides? It's at the time when the head realized the limitation of the head. When your head realized your head can never imagine everything in the universe, then you will know your heart is reasonable. But if someone saying I will able to know anything that as long as I want, then you have a proud, your head is very proud, and then you will never able to find something that inside your heart. So he is able to realize the limitation of the head. Once you are able to realize the limitation of your head, your heart start to explore. Your heart will explore so many things. What? The Word of God. Your heart will be able to understand the Word of God, the miracle of the Bible, the fulfillment of the prophecies, that Jesus is the biggest miracle. What about you? What about you? Are you willing to open your heart and humble yourself? Are you able to humble yourself and recognize the limitation of your head? And you, once you are able to humble yourself, recognize the limitation of your head. That's the time you have harmony. You have harmony between your heart
and your head. Are you willing to?
Not only that, I don't want to stop here. I want to dig deeper inside this scientist's head. I want to dig deeper. What's inside this scientist's head?
Oops.
This scientist's head has two abysses. I will explain more. When this scientist start to explore, do more research, he feels satisfied. Same like me too. In my work, I do electronic design. When I finish a schematic, when I finish a silicon, I feel proud of it. It works. I can make millions of them. It works. Oh, million pieces, not million dollars. Now one piece of electronic circuit, only a few pennies. Okay, so we get achievement feeling from our academic, from our career. When you study, you got A's and A's and A's, you start to see satisfactions. And then when you work, you get promoted, your salary get increased, you get satisfaction. But then this satisfaction is not enough for Pascal. He still feel empty. How come I'm still not satisfied? I'm not satisfied from my career. I'm not satisfied from my academic. He's not satisfied. He searched the amazingly small thing in the universe. An ant, is it small enough? An ant, is it small enough? What else could be smaller than an ant? A grain of sand? What else can smaller be than a grain of sand? Can you think of anything smaller than a grain of sand? A molecule? What's smaller than the molecule? An atom. What's smaller than an atom?
Electron.
Anything smaller than electron?
Yes, the thing that made up electron.
The thing that make up electron. We don't know what thing it is. Some people call them string. Okay. But then what about string? What make up of string? And then he found it. What do you think he found? He called that thing nothing. 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 It is vacuum in his research. Vacuum. Okay. Nothing. And he found nothing. And that's so deep, that's why it's called the abyss of this sign. One abyss he found. That is the abyss. Nothing. And then on the other side, he wants to find something big, bigger than the forest. What else bigger than the forest? Huh? Anything bigger than the forest? The Earth. What's bigger than the Earth? The universe. What is bigger than the universe? The galaxy. Huh?
Infinite.
You got it. You are a smart student. Infinite. He searched to the remote corner of the universe that no one can see, that's invisible. He found infinite. So he is the body sit between these two abysses. Between the abysses of the infinite and also the nothing. His body is shaking because they are so big, so giant, so empty. He's lost inside this infinite. And then he found one thing. In this infinite, they are all not enough. He cannot satisfy his desire, his crave for the academic success, his crave for the career success. That's not enough. His knowledge, doesn't matter how he studied, he still feels empty. He found something that's huge, that is infinite and immutable object. It is God himself. only as big as God can fill this infinite. He found it. He found God to satisfy, to balance his desire to understand more and fill the giant emptiness. What about you? Were you able to admit yourself that only God can give you the ultimate satisfaction? So let's talk about his family. He has two sisters. One is 3 years older than him. The other is 2 years younger. And his mother passed away when he was 4 years old. And he was homeschooling. Homeschooling? We have kids here homeschooling, right? Where are they? Oh, you are homeschooling too. Okay. And the two boys also homeschooling too. And he was homeschooling. He's not only homeschooling when he was in elementary school, high school, even university, he was homeschooling. He never go to school. Well, can you imagine what happened in today's situation? His homeschooling teacher is his father. So your math teacher is your father, your English teacher is your father, your all music teacher is your father, everything is your father. So his father teach him everything. So you can imagine how close a relationship between him and his father. Very, very close, everything for his whole life. Okay. So he has very close relationship with his father. And his father also, besides a tax officer, his father also do some math, some research. And his father doesn't allow him to study anything except common grammar before he was 12 years old. Common grammar. What's common grammar? No language. He is not studying French, not studying Greek, not studying Latin. He just studied common grammar. That's the basic building blocks of language. So language must have yourself, must have other people that you talk to, and the other people you talk to, and then you have to do something. Those are the basic common grammar. He learned common grammar. After he learned common grammar, he is expert in all different languages. When he learned Greek, it falls inside the same common grammar. When he learned Latin, it falls inside the common grammar. He learned the language in very short time, very easy. Easy for him. Any question? So he learned common grammar first. And then his father also planned to let him learn math or other science after he's 16. But this genius, nothing can stop him. He is genius. He did his math research in secret, doesn't let his father know. And then his father discovered. He proved the mathematician Euclid, okay, so it's same name of our street Euclid here. That mathematician Euclid already proved something that went, and Pascal also proved it when he was 12 years old. 12 years old, he proved the sum of the angles of a triangle is two right angle. 12 years old, he has no terminology. He doesn't know what is a straight line. He make up a term for himself. He doesn't know what's a circle. He make up a name for the circle. He proved by himself. And when his father saw it, his father was crying. His father was crying for happy or sad?
Happy.
Happy. Yes. His father was so happy. He proved the math equation. And then his father passed away when he was 28 years old. He was so sad. He has very close relationship with his father. And he wrote a letter to his family. Pascal wrote a letter to his family. Inside, pain like valley of tears. His tears come out of his eyes like a valley. Those kind of pain. But he described further inside the letter. The tear, valley of tears. It is caused by the temptation of the serpent. Why so sad? Why are you so sad? The tears by the temptation of the Satan. He understands well, we should not feel so sad like the pagan. That's no hope. We are Christian. Christian had hope. And then he, inside his letter, he said, we did not lose my father at the moment that, of his death. We had lost him, so as to speak, on the day he entered the church, on the day of his baptism. His body died with Jesus. The sin died with Jesus. He come out of the water, is a new person. So he has hope inside his family. We have Christ inside his family. So it is not just any family. It is a family with hope and with Christ. What about you? Anyone of your family member that is still a pagan, that's no Christ inside? No Christ inside? Pain like valley of tears? What should you do? So this family not only hope in God. He further described his experience when his father passed away. He said this is so Christian. His father passed away so Christian, so happy, so holy, so desirable. So Christian, this Christian turned into an adjective. It's the Christian life. It's so happy. We have hope. We know where we are going. It's so holy. We know the sin is gone. So desirable. It's not that he wants his father to pass away, but that is what God prepared for us. We reach our destination. And then he found consolations. He found comfort. He found comfort inside his heart. Where is this comfort coming from? Is it from ourselves? No. No. Is it from any other human?
No.
Is it from anything that's being created in the world? No. Where's this comfort coming from? Only in God. Only in God. He has the comfort. When he has the comfort, he has the love. The love from God. And he said further. Some other people, I didn't put those texts, some other people thinking that is a natural process. But then he compared the death of Jesus, it's far different with the death of Jesus. It's totally different from the death of Jesus. The death of Jesus is a punishment for sin. It is a punishment for sin. He hates sin. What about you? Would you try to live your Christian life, Christian living, and hate sin as much as Pascal? And the death of Jesus expiate or redeem the crimes of all men. And then he said again, death without Jesus is horrible. It's horrible. So are we able to learn the comfort from Pascal, the love from Pascal? That's only from God we can get those comfort and those love. But one thing, when we study historical characters, we need to be careful on some of their thinking. So in this case, it is Eucharist. Eucharist is the Lord's Supper. So when we have the Lord's Supper, they are thinking that is Jesus' real presence. So something that is not aligned with our understanding, so not aligned with our belief. We think Lord's Supper is a symbol to remember the crucifixion and the redemption of Jesus Christ. Okay, so now we have some understanding of his family. And then something bad happened when he was 30-something years old. That is the Port Royal, I just mentioned Port Royal, right? His sister inside, right? The Port Royal, his sister inside Port Royal. And because of the difference in the thinking or understanding of the Bible, then the more powerful denomination will take over the weaker denomination. And then the more powerful denomination at the time was the Catholic. The Catholic Church wanted to close down that monastery, close it down. And then his denomination is called a Jesuit. So he was 23 years old. And then when he started to write this provincial letter, want to argue with the Catholic people. He was 32 years old. He is going to argue with them. And then inside this letter, he wrote his arguments. And then that's the name of those letters, 20 of them, provincial letter. And then inside the argument, he is claiming the belief of the effectual grace. Effectual grace. They believe salvation. Christians are selected by God. And we rely on the divine grace of God totally. No other thing else. Without God giving us the grace, we cannot be saved. Okay? So that is the effectual grace. And then with the salvation by grace and predestination of God. And then human, after Adam and Eve seen the human fallen, and then we have a sinful nature inside human, we cannot save ourselves. Doesn't matter what we do, we cannot save ourselves. We just can't. And so it is like Peter denied Jesus for 3 times, and then why Jesus could, why Peter can have faith again? It is because of the divine grace. Okay, it's because God give the grace. And then I can compare, I try to imagine, what can I compare? I can compare human, the fallen human, is the sinful human, it's just like the deflated jumping castle, no air. We collapsed, just not standing straight. We can't stand straight. Then once we have the divine grace, we puff up. We have the divine grace, this is like, God selected us. We fill with air. Well, the Catholic people say no. That's the Jesuits. The Catholic people, they say, we need the power of postulate. Power of postulate is whatever you do, you can keep the air pop up. You have to do, you have to work in order to sustaining the grace. And then doesn't matter how small it is okay. And then with the power of possibly, you can follow the Ten Commandments. That's what they want to do. They want to try to see any hole inside the jumping castle, make sure there's no hole, and then any wind we can block. Use human power, human's work. What do you believe? Do you believe in effectual grace or the work of human? That's the deed. In the book of James, deeds is from faith. No deed, faith is dead. What do you believe? We need to understand what do we believe. Our salvation, grace, our salvation, it is like, I can imagine, this comparison is from my another professor. See, our salvation is like sliding on the zip line on a canyon. You saw something like this, right? The zip line on the canyon. You're sliding down. That is your salvation life. You walk your salvation. On one hand, that is the grace of God. You cherish the grace of God. On the other hand, that is your faith, that if with your deed, you need to balance. If you are not balancing, you will tilt it, and then you will slide and walk your salvation like that. Do you want to walk your salvation like that? So you have to do your deed. You have to have your faith. You have to cherish the grace from God to balance, so that we can slide down the salvation zip line smoothly. Well, the argument from Pascal loose, and then the pot boil got closed. So today the topic is fire and God. Now we move to fire and God. So after Pascal passed away, his servant see his jacket so thick inside, and then open up just a piece of paper. This is not Pascal's jacket. It's my jacket. His servant found a piece of paper inside, and it marked with fire, and it marked with God. Something important Pascal hide inside. It is very personal. It's like love letter between him and God. Those intimate, very close relationship with God. And then he hide inside jacket. He want to put it inside, wear the jacket every day. And then that letter, there are many verses, related verses inside the letter. Two of the passages we just read. One was the Exodus 3. Talking about Moses saw a burning bush, and then Moses asked, "My Lord, what name am I to give you?" And then God said, "I am God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." The other verse we just saw is Mary Magdalene. She went back to the tomb of Jesus, and then she found the tomb was empty. And then she didn't realize she was talking to Jesus. And then Jesus talked to her, "Why are you weeping? Mary, tell my brethren that I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Okay, so these red characters, they are inside the paper, okay? And also, some word here, also inside the paper. I didn't turn it red, I forgot. Not of the philosophers and intellectuals. So we want to do some investigation to understand more what he is thinking. What kind of God, what kind of fire? He is thinking something. Why it is related to these two verses? He was thinking. He was the philosopher. Okay? He was the scientist. He has very good intelligence. He was the gentleman of France, and then he was in the upper class. But then he still have some kind of feeling similar to Moses and similar to Mary. What happened to Moses and Mary when they have the divine experience? Moses was scared. Mary was scared. They were afraid. And then they were uncertain. And Pascal wanted to go back. And then he kept reading the verses and reading the verses. It was almost 11 p.m. He went back. After he read the verses, he went back to Mount Horeb. And then he heard some sound that saying, "You already entered to the Holy Land." He stepped inside the Holy Land. And then he put off his shoes. He experienced God. He asked, just like Moses asked. He asked, "My Lord, what name am I to give you?" It's been